Hey guys, it's Danny. Hope you had a great weekend. It is Monday, time to start orchid business once again. Today, I will take you along as I do some maintenance on some of my orchids. We will deal with yellowing leaves, yellowing pseudobulbs even. We'll see when it is okay for us to intervene and when it's not necessary and why the things that we see are happening in the first place. And to start off the subject, let's just start with a very general idea. Yellowing leaves on orchids will eventually happen. The more you grow orchids, the more you'll see them. They don't necessarily mean something bad. Most orchids have a sort of regenerative cycle in the sense that they will discard on their own without anything being wrong the very, very old leaves. Phalaenopsis will lose in time their bottommost leaves, and this doesn't happen every week, every month, every year even. It can happen every few years, depending on the orchid. Oncidiums will lose their oldest leaves as well. Sometimes they will even lose their oldest pseudobulbs as part of this regeneration process. But again, it will happen in years, not overnight. In this case, when we're talking about natural regeneration, there isn't a very urgent need to intervene. The orchid will function as it's supposed to function, and for the most part, it will seal off on its own the point where the leaf used to be attached to the orchid. So in this case, this old leaf fell on its own and it created a perfectly sealed detaching point on the pseudobulb. So there was no need for me to cut it with a scissors or anything, or sterilize the place where it came off or anything of the sorts. That is my preferred way to let things run. Yes, it's not very sightly to have orchids with some yellowing leaves on them, but it is a natural process, and sometimes I can get overwhelmed with the amount of orchids that I have, so I don't really do the maintenance as often as I should, and I have all sorts of leaves on the floor as a result, and all sorts of yellowing leaves in my videos, which, because I do videos and because people don't know what's going on, maybe it's not a good idea. So I'll try to be more on point with the maintenance, but just so you know, in most cases, yellowing leaves, if they're very old, are perfectly normal, and the orchid simply regenerates itself. The yellowing can start at the tip of the leaf and continue, and this can happen within a month or two, or it can yellow altogether pretty fast, depends on the case. But as you can see, this is a very, very old structure. I think it is the oldest pseudobulb on this orchid, so it's absolutely normal. However, there are cases in which we're not dealing with natural yellowing. So I'll bring an example to see if you can spot the difference. Here's an example of an orchid which could use some help. And apart from the obvious, which is this is a monopodial orchid and the one that I showed you before was a sympodial, other than that, when it comes to yellowing leaves, there is no difference when you think about it. So what we need to look for are yellowing leaves that are old. And in our case, we can see that the yellowing happens on a leaf which is fairly fresh. It is the second leaf down. And this is what makes this particular yellowing unnatural. And if we don't want to risk complications or losing the orchid, we kind of need to intervene. Now, furthermore, on this orchid, you can see some spotting as well. And actually, this is the cause for this particular leaf yellowing. This orchid had an infestation of spider mites this summer, which I absolutely missed. I don't know how, but I did. And the grazing on the leaves opened up the leaf for secondary infections. And I have here, I think, a bacterial or fungal infection, whatever it might be, it needs to come off. I'm just noticing now, in the light, these black spots are glistening, which means I'm dealing with a bacterial infection. So, what affects this leaf is a pathogen, not natural regeneration. So let's see how to go about this. First of all, I need to wash my hand because I did not wear gloves, and these sort of things can transfer to other orchids by unwashed hands. So I'll go and do that. Next, we need a sterilized pair of pruners or shears or scissors, whatever you have at your disposal. I sterilize my pair of whiskers with alcohol and then a flame. But this is not obligatory, and really if you want to keep it absolutely safe, and if you're a very young grower, just use alcohol on a cotton swab or something and just wipe the blades, and that should be perfectly fine. Given that I have a lot of orchids, statistically, I actually deal with more issues and pathogens than the average grower, I think. So that's why I want to be extra safe, but typically the flame is not really needed. Just a side note there. So what I want to do is eliminate this infection. But being that I established that the source of the infection is the actual grazing of the spider mite, I don't only need to cut this portion, which is yellowing, under the yellowing and call it a day, I will actually cut below these darkened spots. If I move the leaf a little, hopefully you can see on camera, hopefully it translates, they're glistening, they're active, they're not dried infections. So what I need to do is cut the leaf right here, way below the yellowing part. Because I know that if I cut it right here and eliminate only this part, this can come back since these are active. And I will cut the leaf at an angle just to make it look a little bit more natural. And there we have it. This needs to go directly into the trash. Additionally, I like to put a little bit of cinnamon powder, the one you find in supermarkets, on this leaf cut that I made here. This will seal it from other pathogens in the air and also help it dry a little bit faster. There are some people who say that cinnamon shouldn't work because it repels water. Well, the thing is, cinnamon doesn't actually mix with water because it's bark, but it's very, very finely milled. Think about the bark we're using with orchids. Initially, it will not necessarily get wet, it will not soak up water, but the more you leave it in water, it will expand a little bit. The structures will expand and it will hold a little bit of water. It's the same with cinnamon. Eventually, if it stays wet enough, it will get wet. It will not dissolve because it is actually bark, but it will get wet. Now on the second leaf, you might have noticed that I have a few dots as well, and I took a look and they do glisten, meaning they are active and this leaf will have the same fate if I don't do anything. But the problem is, this leaf only has about 3 spots and only 2 of them are active, as I can see. So cutting half of the leaf just for 3 spots, maybe I can do better than this. I'm going to try and spot heal this leaf with a drying agent. Now in the other case, I didn't want to go this route because I was dealing with a multitude of spots. And statistically speaking, the more spots you have, the more chances you have of not actually treating all of them. So even if just one would still remain active, the leaf would be compromised. However, here, having only 3 spots, the chances of me succeeding in drying all of them are greater. Can you tell I like statistics? So for this, I'm going to be using hydrogen peroxide 6%. Usually on my orchids, I use 3% on the roots to eliminate snails, but we're dealing with something worse than snails here. So what I will do is dip a cotton Q-tip in hydrogen peroxide 6% and go on these dots and spot treat them. I don't want to use hydrogen peroxide on the entire leaf because after the initial fizzing reaction, all I will have left is water. And putting water in the crown and stuff, just for 3 spots, not worth it. I would much rather do the spot treatment. So I'm just gonna let the hydrogen peroxide do its thing. After a few minutes, it will stop being hydrogen peroxide and become water. So after 10 minutes, if there is any water left, I will remove it. And what I will do again with a cotton Q-tip, I will put a little bit of cinnamon on these spots as well. And hopefully this will be enough to completely eliminate the infection, to render it inactive, and thus saving the entirety of the leaf. If I see that this is not enough, obviously I will go ahead and cut the leaf under these spots as well, but I'm trying to save it initially. This particular orchid, I have to say, it is a magnet, an absolute magnet for spider mites. So I need to keep my eye on it. It's a Dimorphorchis lowi actually. And as long as it's spider mite free, it looks good. But yeah, spider mites really like it. You can see the dots of oil. I just treated it the other week. That's why it appears a little bit glossy. So mind you, if you have this orchid, be careful with spider mites. They seem to really like it. Now, these types of very dark spots, even though they are caused by something unnatural, let's say, although it's natural, pathogens are natural as well, don't necessarily mean that you need to intervene. Sometimes on some orchids, the infection will simply stop on its own, the orchid will take care of it. And it is the case of this Cattleya orchid, which apparently had a little bit of water trapped under the sheaths as the pseudobulb was forming, and this affected a little bit the pseudobulb. You can see I have some dark spots here, but they're not active. They don't actually bring any moisture to the surface, and they haven't advanced in a month or so. So in this particular instance, I don't need to remove parts of the pseudobulb because the infection doesn't appear to extend. If at any point in time I see it extend, Obviously, I will intervene, but if it doesn't, I risk doing more harm to the orchid. If I start to myself produce open doors for pathogens, that might not end well. So for now, I'm not even going to put hydrogen peroxide or anything on this. I'm just gonna let it be. It appears to be rather dry. If it's advancing, if it is active, we should intervene. If not, then not. In some cases though, the pseudobulbs are so affected that we do actually need to intervene. In the previous case, as you saw, we had some black spots on the pseudobulb, but pretty much that's it. Other than that, the pseudobulb was green, had a green leaf. Well, in this case, we can see that the bulb has a black streak here. It looks kinda yellow, kinda shriveled, and all of the leaves sprouting from it are falling off. Look at this. Here's an interesting study case. We can see that this leaf has a tip which is green, and then it gets yellow, and then it gets brown towards the base, unlike the previous leaf we saw. Well, this only means that the infection starts at the base, not at the tip. So in this case, we cannot cut the tip and call it a day. So we need to investigate what causes the infection at the pseudobulb. And to be honest, I cannot tell for sure what is affecting this pseudobulb because this is a brand new orchid. It is my cymbidium that we just repotted. If you remember in my presentation video, I was showing you that this particular one was not in great shape. We had a new growth rotting off, now the pseudobulb. So I do believe that the orchid was watered from the top and then water just got trapped there. It did not evaporate due to lack of ventilation and that caused some issues. I do believe the plant as a whole can absolutely be saved. And look at this, one of the spikes actually decided to open the buds. But definitely we need to remove that pseudobulb there, which is causing issues. Now, sadly, this is a central pseudobulb. It connects everything. So what we're gonna do is cut the pseudobulb and leave the rhizome alone and hopefully, fingers crossed, we can get away with it. Hopefully the infection is not actually affecting the rhizome. To do this, a pair of pruners or shears can be used, but since this is a central pseudobulb, I think I will do better with this tool. So what I will try to do is remove the pseudobulb but leave the connection alone. So let's see how to go about it. I will go at the base of the pseudobulb and making sure that I don't affect the other structures, I will try to cut it. And there we have it. Let's take a look and see if we did a good job. The idea was not to cut into the pseudobulb, but right at the connection with the rhizome, and it appears that that's what we did. Yay! I was actually relying on instinct more than anything because I could not see what I was doing. I have a camera before the orchid. But it looks like we did a good job. And also, can you see this? The pseudobulb is rather moist. This is an active infection. Now here we have good news and bad news. The bad news is we weakened this particular pseudobulb because we actually removed a little bit of the rhizome. So the connection is not as strong. It's okay though, the pseudobulb is still connected, so all we need to do is stake it so that its weight doesn't actually disconnect it even more. This one appears to be okay, so I'm going to add a stake for the pseudobulb and come back to seal off this cut wound. So I used two bamboo skewers to stabilize and actually push the pseudobulb rather than stake it in the back. And now let's see about this place on the rhizome. I will remove a few of these dried sheets just to see better what I'm dealing with. And I don't actually see anything glistening, anything moist here, which is good. So again, what I will do is simply use some hydrogen peroxide, this time 3%, because I can spray it. And I'm gonna spray it right here. Now in this case, I will not add cinnamon. In my experience, rhizomes, which are very, very woody, are not as prone to having secondary infections. What are prone are pseudobulbs and leaves because they're very fleshy, they're not woody, they have a lot of sap. So pathogens can travel a lot better. This does not mean that the rhizome can never get infected. It just means that my experience has not been it and I don't see the point of adding cinnamon to it. But if you see the point and if you feel better just adding cinnamon or whatever other drying agent you have, then go ahead and use it. I'm just not gonna use it. It has worked pretty well for me, but I did want to add hydrogen peroxide because I want to eliminate spores or other things that might be on this rhizome, just to make sure. Given that this orchid is sitting outside, and outside I have a lot of wind, again, there's no need to remove this water. It will go away on its own in about 10 minutes. So in this case, our job is pretty much done. So I'll keep you up to date with this in video. As you've seen, cases in which pseudobulbs are affected can easily be treated as well. The only problem is when we don't have enough pseudobulbs. And I did have a case about a couple of weeks ago. My Nelly Eiler had only one mature, viable, healthy pseudobulb, which was responsible with the new growth, and it lost it. It got infected, it needed to be removed, and I had to remove the new growth together with it. All I was left with was the back bulb, and in the case of that particular hybrid, it's not easy to restart it from a back bulb, so I just went ahead and purchased a new one. So these issues can be quite bad depending on the orchid you're working with. If you have multiple pseudobulbs, things are not that bad, and that's how I would go about things. I would just remove that particular pseudobulb and leave the rhizome alone. But of course, you do need to treat with importance these types of things. And I know that there are some people who always think, what would the orchid do in nature? Do we actually need to intervene and do all of these things? Well, the answer is pretty simple. You absolutely don't need to, but then you will subject the orchid to natural selection, which is number one rule in the wild. So if you're comfortable with natural selection and the possibility of your orchid to not be selected, then that's fine. But if you want to make sure that you are helping it and you're treating it and you're not following nature's rules, then we kind of need to intervene. And another thing, infections will not always glisten. They will not always be bacterial. They can be of all sorts of shapes and causes. Sometimes the leaf will simply yellow off without any spots, case in which it is still an infection and it still needs intervention. Sometimes you will not have an infection, you will just have some leaf tip dieback. You can cut it away if you don't like it, if it's not appealing. And the way to do that is just like any other infection. We just need to go below the yellow line. So in this case, this is not an infection here, but let's pretend it is. You can see we have a brownish, dryish part and also below it a yellowing part. When we want to eliminate an infection, we need to go below the yellow part, well below, maybe half an inch or so, maybe a little more, and give a good cut. If we would cut it here, it will now mean that we eliminated all of the infection, because the infection is here and this is the effect of the infection. With leaf tip dieback, it's not as important to cut into good tissue, but just to be sure, you can cut it below the yellow line 1 centimeter or so. Spotting an infection is not necessarily super easy, even for experienced growers. So what I might consider to be a little bit of dieback due to dryness or temperatures or whatever might actually be a very weird infection. So I always cut into good tissue. I don't cut directly on the line. And I think that's a safe way of going about things. And I think that is the end of the video. These were the orchids that needed my attention. I will go around my greenhouse and see what other orchids could use some help. Again, as I was saying, I should be a little bit more diligent in maintaining my orchids rather nice looking since I'm doing videos. I always say this, hopefully this time I will actually keep it up. But yeah, you don't have to remove all of the yellowing leaves if they're not infections. You can let them be and the orchid will take care of them on its own. One thing that I never cut are the phalaenopsis leaves, the ones from the bottom, but with the oncidiums, I could be a little bit more diligent. Anyway, this was the video for today. I hope you've enjoyed it and you learned something new. You will always deal with some issues with your orchids. The more orchids you have, the more years you grow orchids, but it's okay. These things happen and it's absolutely normal. So I hope this video was helpful and you know the drill, like or dislike this video below, subscribe to my channel for regular orchid videos, tutorials, Q&As and other fun orchid subjects. And if you wish to support the channel, do consider visiting the merch store down below. And with that said, I'll see you guys next time. Bye!